You can't come from a spirit of worship like that and be sitting still. Listen, we got to get up on our feet. We got to give God our highest praise for what he's done in our lives. What he did this morning, we saw 5 salvations this morning. If that don't make a Baptist get up and shout, I don't know what will. Come on. 5 salvations, a married couple, and they're here tonight. They're here tonight. You can't tell me God don't work no more. You can't tell me he don't do nothing no more. Because God is still in the business of saving people. Come on. Let's give a 10-second praise break. Let's go. Let's roll with it. 10. Come on, church. 9. 8. I see you, brother. 7. 6. 5. 4. 3. 2. All right, let's go. Yeah. Come on. It's so good to see a couple that accepts Jesus this morning at church tonight. That makes you know it's real. Let you know it's real. This spirit this morning was real. The spirit tonight is real. So, I've been seeing a lot of different things take place in my life and take place in Campbellsville for the past little bit. And I feel like God put a word on my heart tonight that's gonna get a couple of your toes. Go ahead and warn you. I ain't got your steel-toe boots on. I'll give you 5 minutes to go to your truck and get them. But God's going to give you life tonight. I proclaim that. God's going to release you from something tonight that you've been holding on to for so long that you're used to holding on to it. That you've been used to dealing with. You've been sitting there, sitting in it, waiting. So, well, God, if you want to take it, go ahead, but I don't expect you to. I'm just going to deal with it for the rest of my life. But God's going to take it tonight. I'm telling you, if you receive it tonight, God's going to take it tonight. But I've been seeing something different take place in Campbellsville over the past 3 months that I've never seen before, that I've never witnessed before. I'm 19 years old, but I've seen a lot of things, you know. I've seen cancerous cells leave off of a woman's body like that. You know, we were sitting in a church, and a man says, pray with me over this woman. She had 2-inch cells all over her body sent up off her arms. And by the time we were done praying, they were gone. You can't tell me God don't work. But God's been doing something in Campbellsville that I've never seen before. And God gave me a vision. And for those of you that think, well, he's just a kid. He's only 19 years old. Well, Joel chapter 2, verse 28 says young men will have visions. So, booyah, I had one. But I remember very vividly, I was standing on top of the water tower, bypass water tower. How I got there, I don't know. I do a lot of unexpected things very weirdly. Don't ask questions. But I was up there, and I was looking around. I was like, why am I up here? What am I doing? You know, it's slippery. It's weird. It's huge. I don't like heights. And God said, look towards town. I looked towards town, and there's a huge white cloud over top of it. And at that time, I didn't know what that meant. At that time, I didn't know what God was doing. At that time, I didn't know why he gave me that vision. I was like, well, okay, God, whatever you say, you know. Then I looked to my right, and there's a gray cloud leaving Campbellsville. I looked to my left towards Greensburg, and there's nothing but white cloud. You know, some of you don't mean what that means, but I'm going to break it down for you today. Because I spent the last 3 weeks studying and wearing myself out, getting alone in my prayer closet, neglecting my family. Not really, but I'm just kidding. But I spent time studying on this, so I kind of know what I'm talking about. But I looked up on Google what the white cloud meant in biblical terms. In Hebrew, the white cloud means God's presence. God's presence was over top of Campbellsville. Come on. Come on. God's presence is reigning over top of Campbellsville. And then I looked up what the gray cloud meant. The gray cloud stands for depression. Catch me here. Gray cloud stands for depression. Gray cloud stands for anxiety. Gray cloud stands for jealousy. For those of you that have been in Campbellsville for very long, you know that spirit of jealousy has been here for a long time. But I'm telling you, God's doing something so big in this place. But anyways, going on, I've seen an outpouring of God's Holy Spirit over the past 2 weeks like never before. I've seen people healed from pain and agony. I have seen numerous salvations and healings. I think alone at Elkhorn, we've seen probably about 30 salvations in the past 3 months. Yeah, I'm right. I'm on that. But going on, it says, I'm getting lost here. I'm getting on track. Going on, it says, so after I experienced the vision, I asked God, what did you mean by the white cloud? And God said, my presence is over Campbellsville. I'm about to pour something out into Campbellsville like never before. I kept researching on the white clouds and what they meant. What God meant by the white clouds, and he said, Jared, I want you to listen to me very closely. He said, I want you to go to Exodus chapter 40. For those of you know, it's an Old Testament term. But I want you to listen to me very carefully. God gave me a word out of this book that I've never looked at God this way before. And so I want to give you perspective on how to look at God like maybe you've never seen before. Some of you, maybe you can look at God like you've never looked at God before because you've never seen God before. And so going into Exodus chapter 40. Why am I in Psalms? All right. Verse 36, it says, "And all the travels of the Israelites, whenever the cloud lifted from above the tabernacle," those of you don't know, the tabernacle was what the Israelites set up for the presence of God whenever he would come to their place. They were set up for the people could bring their sacrifice to pay for their sins, because this was before Jesus came to earth. So they had to pay for their sins by sacrificing a lamb or a ram or a physical sacrifice. So they come to the tabernacle, and they said, above the tabernacle, they would set out. But if the cloud did not lift, they did not set out until the day it lifted. So the cloud of the Lord was over the tabernacle by day, and fire was in the cloud by night in the sight of all the Israelites during all their travels. You know, I spent a lot of yesterday on the road. And I just need to get off by myself. And a lot of stuff going on. Satan was trying to intervene. And I said, I got to go by myself and get away. And so I took every back road a human being could take. I did not know where I was, but I ended up in Somerset. Don't know how I got there, but I knew how to get back home, so that's all I was worried about. So I was in Somerset, and then God said, go down to the river. I was like, well, okay, God, I'll go down to the river. What do you want me to do at the river? He said, I want you to turn my worship music on. I want you to get into my word. I want you to pay attention very closely. So I was sitting here studying. I was praying. I was looking for what God was doing. I got distracted by these little minnows sitting over here on my right, swimming in a little puddle. You know, the river's running quickly, and there's minnows over here playing around. And I started looking at them, and I was like, God, why did you put these minnows right here? He said, just watch them for a minute. And so they were all swimming in a school or whatever, and this one minnow, he turned around and started going against the stream. He started going upstream. And God said, Jared, I want you to pay attention very closely. He said, I'm taking you somewhere that no one else is going. You know, Bobby, God's taking you somewhere that no one else is going. You know, I can't go where you're going. In the end, I'll meet you where we're all going. But I can't go on the same path you're going. You know, God's taking each of us on a different path. But you know, this is where the cloud comes back into play. It says in Exodus that God was the light, God was the cloud, and the Israelites followed the cloud. You know, they followed the presence of God. And so when the cloud would move, they would pick up their stuff, pack up, and go in a hurry because they did not want to miss where the glory of God was going to be at. You know, they didn't want to miss what God was going to do at the next place, at the next destination, because they knew God was doing something big, bigger than they could even imagine. But God told me, he said, Jared, am I the cloud you're following? You know, am I the spirit you're following? When I'm the cloud and I look up, I'm like, I only see the cloud, you know? And I was down in Somerset, and it was kind of a gloomy day. I look up and saw a big, white, puffy cloud. You know, of all places, I'm like, well, God, you send me to Somerset on every blessed back road in the backwoods, seeing Sasquatch and all that kind of stuff. But I look up and there's a big, white cloud sitting there. And I'm like, well, God, what are you trying to tell me? He says, Jared, my people need to watch my cloud instead of watching where their feet are going. You hearing me? You need to watch the Holy Ghost instead of watching where your feet are going. Because you watch where your feet are going, you're going to step in a puddle. Before you know it, you're going to be knee-deep in something you didn't want to be knee-deep in. Then you're going to be in over your head. But if you're watching your cloud, you're going to be walking on the water. You're going to be conquering the mountain that you're going to struggle with. Because God says, if you watch me, I will take care of everything else in your path. Now going on, he says, now Jared, there's some people that are going to be there tomorrow night. And he said, that are going to be running from me. He said, they started out following me. They're like, God, I trust you. I believe you. I'm going where you're going. I'm watching you. I'm seeing you. What are you doing? Where are you taking me? But then they look down. Then they're in the middle of an ocean. Then they fall. You know, and pride cometh before a fall. There's people in this church alone that struggle with pride. You know, I used to struggle with pride so bad. You know, I used to struggle with coming. I was like, no, I don't need to go to the river. I'm in the front row. That's close enough. You know, I'm close enough. I'm in the river. I'm close enough falling off the stage right now. I'm good. You know, but God says, no. He said, I want you over top of your head in my river. You know, but if you fully watch God, God's going to take care of everything else. But don't let Satan get in your ear. Say, hey, look, there's an even better path over here. It's flat. It's smooth. And it goes straight on forever. You can see where you're going. You can see the things that I'm going to do for you. I'll give you a nice house, a clean bathroom, all the money you want. But why would you do that? Because giving up on God is a resemblance of pride. When you give up on God, you're saying, God, I don't need you anymore. I'm going to handle this on my own. No, that's me. That's a me factor. That's a me factor. So, well, I'm good. I got it. Me got it. I got it. I'm going to do what I have to do. I'm going to take care of myself. But when you take it, walk into Satan's path, and you walk down Satan's path, and you sit here, you're walking, you're smooth, you're chilling, and you keep walking, and you keep walking, and you run into something. Oh, that's nice. I got a nice car. I got a cool car. Next thing you know, whoa, you run into a cliff. Pride cometh before a fall. Is it making sense now? Yep. And Satan intervenes in your life, and he gets you distracted. He's taking you to a cliffside because he wants to see you fall like never before. Yeah, he can give you all this nice stuff in the beginning. He can give you a nice car, a nice house, a big tax return, all the cool stuff in the world, you know, a nice Apple Watch or a free Apple Watch or anything like that. But where is he leading you to? Satan wants nothing more than to see you fall because he knows what you're going to do for God's kingdom on the other side of that. You know, I'm spitting everywhere up here. But inside of that, if you, any time that you want to get back to God, God says, I will light up my cloud like a fire. Inside of the darkness, you can still see God's cloud because it's lit up like a fire, you know. So you can go back to him and say, God, I want to trust you again. I give you everything inside of me. You know, I watched as a married couple walk across this front right here and went into that way. And I watched as they followed a cloud into that way saying, God, I trust you. I give you everything inside of me now because I want to go where you're at. Now, it wasn't BRAF preaching. It wasn't anybody, and it wasn't anything else but God saying, follow me because I have better things in store for you than Satan can ever give to you. You know, but I want to get back onto something real quick because God has really hit depression inside of me really hard. And I don't know who in here is struggling with it. I'm up here sweating like a dog. I don't know who in here is struggling with it. But God's taking you somewhere that nobody can touch you. You know, God's going to protect you. And I wrote this down, and I want you guys to write it down too. It says, one of my second points, and I got on the first one. Well, I haven't got to the first one yet either. But anyway, let's go to the first one. It says, what are you willing to sacrifice for God? That's my first point. What sacrifices are you willing to give to God? These Israelites, they left their families at home. They left their money at home. They left their time. They gave all their time to serving the Lord. They gave everything they had to serving the Lord. They gave everything they had for when God got up and moved, they moved with him. They gave it all up. But in the end, God supplied for them. He gave them food. He gave them nourishment. He gave them everything they needed. Not necessarily what they wanted, but he gave them everything they needed. You know, I don't have everything I want. I have some nice things. I have a few nice things. But I have everything I need. You know, I have a truck that gets me where I'm supposed to go. It doesn't run great, but I have a truck that gets me where it's supposed to go. You know, I have clothes on my back. I have shoes to wear, nice shoes to wear. I mean, I think these are pretty nice. I have a beautiful girlfriend. I have a family that loves me. And I have a church family that loves me. You know, that's all I need. You know, that's all that you need. Because God is going to take care of you. When you get up, you stick your face up. No, you're not being prideful. You're not sticking your nose up in the air like I'm too good for all this. You're focusing on God. You're focusing on the Holy Spirit cloud, a cloud called glory. And you're following that. You're trusting that. I had this saying today, it came into my mind. It said, you can't conquer the mountain until you trust God to conquer it with you. You know, Satan's going to show you a path to walk around it. But in that path that you're walking around it, when you're avoiding that situation, you're going to fall even farther. You know, you're going to get turned around. You're going to take another wrong turn. It's going to get you right back where you were at the very beginning. I've been there. I've done that. You know, I've tried to avoid stuff. I've tried to get by things. I'm like, well, I can do this and it'll be okay. Then I'll keep going. I'll get my life right. You know, I can do this again, and I'll be okay. I get my life right again. But God says, no, you need to conquer that mountain and quit walking around it. Because you walk around it, you're going to keep having to face it every single time. But God says, if you will follow me, he says, let nothing, no thing hinder my children from following me. Ain't nothing but a thing. Ain't nothing but a thing. I tell people that all the time. They get so mad at me. They'll be like, well, Jared, I'm struggling with this. I text them back, ain't nothing but a thing. Like, well, what do you mean? I said, exactly what it says. Ain't nothing but a thing. Like, well, it's something. I'm like, yeah, it's a thing. Do you realize what you just said? Something. It's a thing. Ain't nothing but a thing. Nothing can hinder you from following God's mercy. Nothing. No thing. Ain't nothing but a thing. I live off that because things are what hindered my life. And sometimes it breaks my heart. Because I want to sit back and think, I'm like, God, where would I be at if I had just completely surrendered to you whenever you call it, whenever you saved me? God, where would you have taken me? You know, and here's what he said. He said, you're back on the right path. You're going to get there, but you got to keep pushing. You got to keep pushing. You can't rush me, but you got to keep pushing. Because I got to work a couple things out in your life, but I'm going to get you right back where you want to be. You know, 6 months ago, I didn't have my joy anymore. You know, some of you know that. Some of you I wouldn't talk to. I wouldn't even such as look at your way because I was like, you know what? I'm on my own. I'm good. You know, I'm going to sit up here in the front row and worship and leave. And I'm going to show up at Wednesday night on 6 o'clock and leave at 8 o'clock and all that good stuff because I'm good. I'm good. I got my stuff. I'm good. Again, God broke me. He said, you're not following me. I was like, yeah, I am. I go to church. I go to church. I show up. I say hi to the people I need to say hi to. Say hi to the guests. And I'm like, hey, how are you doing? And how's your mom? And all that kind of good stuff. But then God said, no, you're not following me. I'm like, well, what are you talking about? He said, you were getting ready to take a job that I didn't want you to take. He said, you're getting ready to go down a path I didn't want you to go down because you had let people in the church make you mad enough to leave. And I gotta confess now, I'm not into it. I was going to accept a job way out of state, just get away from everybody because I was ready to leave. You know, I was done. Like, well, you know what? I'll go out on my own. I think I'm ready. I think I'm good. But then God said, no. I'm not done with you at Elkhorn yet. And it took a probably 2.5 hour truck ride with Donnie Bird to get me back straight. And I was talking to him. I said, Donnie, I'm done. I'm leaving. You know, I'm taking this job. I'm gone. See you. Bye. See you. He said, no, you're going to screw up. I was like, what are you talking about? He said, this time if you screw up, you're screwed. He said, because you're by yourself and you won't know what to do because you won't have to support anybody else. You know, here I've got the support of everybody. You guys support me. You guys are here to support me. Ultimately, you're here to support God. And I'm sorry, I almost messed up. You know, I've had to apologize to so many people, but I need to apologize to my church family. You know, I'm sorry. That I wasn't being the man of God that I was supposed to be. That's my fault. You know, I was hindering so many other people's lives because I blow them off like nobody's business. You know, they text me with these biblical questions. Well, what does this mean? I'd read it and delete, lock my phone, and go on. Then God broke me. He said, you're hurting my people. You know, I'm putting them in your path. You're hurting my people. You know, you're not following me. I'm putting these people in your path. You're supposed to look into my cloud. You're supposedly following me. I'm putting these people in your path, and you're not doing anything. You're not any good to me. And so God broke me. But thank you guys for never giving up on me. I've gotten off track a little bit. I'm sorry. But thank you for never giving up on me, because I wouldn't be where I am today if it wasn't for you. But anyways, back on track. God wants to know, what are you willing to sacrifice for him? Are you willing to sacrifice your time? Are you willing to sacrifice your money? Money's a big deal for me. I'm on a tight budget. Me and Madison, we budget date. You know, we got Taco Bell like once a week. That's about all we get. But anyways, going to that, are you willing to sacrifice money for God? Are you willing to sacrifice your lifestyle for God? Are you willing to sacrifice your vehicles for God, your love for God, your lifestyle for God? Are you willing to sacrifice your job for God? What are you willing to do? Because these Israelites, they picked up and left everything behind. I said, I got to go. You know, God is on the move, and I got to go. What are you willing to put down? Sometimes, are you willing to put down your phone? You know, because some of you want to sit in bed on Facebook or Instagram for 6 hours and go to sleep at 3 o'clock and get up at 6 and be a scene at work. That's a good word to use. You want to be a scene at work. You want to make a scene. You want to be all upset, like, well, shut up, I'm tired. It's your fault. You didn't go to bed till 2 o'clock in the morning. That's your fault. You know, you're the one, it's your problem that you're causing the hindrance to somebody else. Oh, there goes one toe. So, what are you willing to sacrifice? Sometimes it's your friendships. You know, there goes another toe. Are your friends lifting you up? Or are they tearing you down? Are they distracting you? If they're distracting you, they're not your friend. If they're distracting you, they're not supposed to be a part of your lifestyle. Because God says, let no thing hinder my children from following me. Bam. Money. Put that one in the bank, Bobby. Let no thing hinder my children from following me. Is it your friends? Is it your family? Ooh. No, you're not supposed to ditch your family. You're supposed to love them. No, but sometimes you got to love them from a little bit of a distance. You know, love your family with all your heart and all your mind and all your strength, because they're the ones that gave you life. But at the same time, if you show that you're growing in God, they're going to ask you questions. Richie Taylor, I'm going to call you out. God changed Richie's life. Just Richie's life. Just one person. Next thing you know, his whole family's in church. Next thing you know, his brother's getting saved. Next thing you know, his wife comes forth, his brother's wife comes forth today and gets saved. You can't tell me God does not work anymore. God used one man to change a whole family, and he's not done with him yet. You know? Come on, God. Shoot, y'all ain't getting this. What are you willing to sacrifice for God? Your time or your money? What are you doing? Point two, don't try to get ahead of the cloud. Don't try to get ahead of God. Because then, what are you doing? Wrong. You're setting yourself up for failure. There's a reason God's in front of you. Because God is going forward. God is going in front of you to protect you. Because God knows what's going to happen. You know, don't rush God. Don't you dare rush God. Because God said, I'll get things done in my time. You rush him, you're going to hurt yourself. You know, I'm a guy, I'm not patient. Madison knows that, I'm not patient. I can't wait 3 minutes before she texts me back. I'm not patient. But God has been teaching me patience, because he said, if you rush me, I'm not going to bless you. Because I can't bless you, because you're trying to get into your blessings that I haven't set up for you yet. Ooh, that's a good one too. What are you waiting for? Don't rush God. Don't get ahead of the cloud. Because if you get ahead of the cloud, you're going to run into something you don't want to. See, God guided these people, these Israelites. He didn't take them through a city because there was war going on. You know, he said, no, I'm going to take you this way because I'm protecting you. See, if the Israelites had went ahead of God and tried to plan for where God was going to be, they would have wound up in this city where war was going on. And they would have been caught up right in the middle of it. They'd have been shut down. A lot of them would have been killed because they're walking around with a bunch of tents and a bunch of heavy gold stuff, you know, with the Ark of the Covenant and all that kind of stuff. They're walking around with all that. So they're vulnerable. You know, they've got God on their side, but you're still caught up in a war. You know, you went in front of God. God said, no, you weren't supposed to go that way because you're supposed to follow me. Yes, you can still turn around and go back to God, but you've got to take some time to get back there. So what... Don't go ahead of the cloud. And the reason we're chasing God, I want you to write this down. The reason we are chasing God is because God is going before us, clearing the way so that we can handle it. Not that we can do it with ease. You know, God didn't design everything for us to handle it. He had designed everything for us to be able to handle it, not to be able to do it with ease. God says, I'll never give you anything more than you can handle. You know, you can handle this stuff. I've handled many different things. I've almost, to a point, almost ruined my relationship. Because I handled it wrong. But God broke me. He said, Jared, you're not trusting me like you're supposed to. You're not following me like you're supposed to. He said, you're going the wrong way. God broke me. He said, if you jack around one more time, you're going to lose her. I don't know that we're going to get married. I don't know that. I hope so. But God has changed my life through that. Because I tried to get in front of God. I tried to rush stuff. I went in front of God. I said, God, I'm good. I got this. You know, chill out. I'm going in front of you. You're sitting right there. You're good. I'm going to get a little bit ahead of you so you can catch up to me in a minute. But then I was supposed to take a left turn. I took a right. And that's where I messed up. But where God's mercy comes in, he says, it's okay. You can turn back around, come back, and you can sit with me for a while. I'll hold you for a little bit. I'll let you get that stuff out. I'll let you sit on my lap. I'll comfort you. I'll give you your peace back. He said, and then follow me again. I'll take you the right way. You know, then another thing I want to talk about. What cloud are you following? This can get intense. Are you following the gray cloud that's going down a straight path? Or are you following a white cloud that's taking you over oceans and through the river and across the bridge and through the woods. Because I promise you, if you're chasing after God's heart, it ain't going to be easy. But it's going to be breezy. Because before you know it, you're going to be sitting on the other side looking back and say, God, you brought me through all that. You're never going to forget where you came from. Come on now. Come on now. You're never going to forget where you came from. Pride cometh before you fall. When you forget where you're coming from, that's where your pride's at. That's where you've taken the wrong turn. But I'm telling you today, God says, I can take your pride back from you. I can give you your joy back. I can give you your passion back. I can take your depression from you. I can give you your peace back. I can turn you around and take you back home. Where's Beth Cocker? Beth, God's moving in your life. Chase after God. I watch you every day, every Sunday you worship, and every Sunday your worship's different. Your worship keeps changing because you're chasing after God. You know, you're one of my worship role models because I sit back. I don't sit here and take a video. That's weird. But I sit here and I watch you on Sunday morning, and it blesses me so much. You know, keep running after God. And when God doesn't move, don't you dare move. But when God moves, I dare you to chase after him. You know, because God's doing so much in your life. You and Scott both. I love watching you both worship on Sunday mornings because you have the heart of God. You know, when God doesn't move, and I love the song that says, Lord, where you go, I'll go, and where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move, and what you pray, I'll pray. Right. Don't go somewhere God's not. Oh, come on. Don't you dare step foot in a bar anymore, Richie Taylor. God's not there. You ain't going to. Don't you dare step foot somewhere not supposed to, but don't you dare click on that website one more time because God's not there. God's not there. Put it away. Put it up. Get rid of it. Give it to God because God says, when you're following me, that's where I'll be. But going on, my third point, I got to get somewhere. Don't stray off the path onto the easy path. God never wants us to allow the world to get in the way of the relationship. Chris and Spencer, y'all come up here real quick. With him, God says, let nothing hinder me from the God. Let nothing. Hurry up. Come on. I ain't got time for this. I'm sweating. I'm about to die. But anyway, Spencer, you're God because you're wearing white. Chris, you're just a sinner. Come y'all don't understand. Come stand right here behind him. All right. This is what I'm going to do. All right. Stand right there. Right there. All right. That's what I'm doing. It's a physical representation of what's going to happen when you let the world get in the way. Because I'm a big boulder. I'm shaped like the world. That's why I wore blue today, because the world's mostly blue. Okay? Now, can you see Spencer? What? That's my point. All right, y'all can sit down. All right. God says, let nothing get in my way. Don't let the world entertain you. I wanted to do that because I thought it was pretty cool. But anyways, and he says, the devil is in your ear, is Satan, trying to get you to think you're too good for the beaten path that God has taken you on, and you're going to take the smooth and straight road. Don't take the smooth and straight road. I'm warning you now, because God has taken camels to somewhere we've never been before. Right. So I'm warning you now, you keep your eyes focused on God. You know, I had this conversation with God yesterday. I loved it. I was sitting down on the river. You know, I had the nice little praise and worship going on. You know, I had the elevation worship going on. I was in my feels. You know, I was crying a little bit. But God said, Jared, don't you dare take your eyes off of me. He said, because I'm taking you somewhere that no man your age has ever seen before. Yep. You know, Bobby, God's taking you somewhere no man your age has ever seen before. We're a little far apart, okay? But we're good. You know, you're just going to see Jesus before I do. Maybe. I don't know. You might outlive us all. But keep your guard on and keep your eyes up. Because I'm telling you today, I watched a Stephen Furtick video. I love this one. It says, Satan has assigned a demon to you because he knows where you're going. Satan said, I want to put one demon on him because he's easy to distract. He's easy to get off of his focus. He's easy to get down. But I got to put two on this one because he's a little more focused. You know, I pray today that you guys in there, Satan has to put 16 demons on you to guard you because you're so focused on God. And even those demons cannot hinder you because you're so focused on God. Come on now. Satan is trying to intervene in your life right now because God is doing something so big in Campbellsville, Kentucky that nobody's ever seen before. It's been prophesied for years. Revival is going to start in the heart of Kentucky. Revival is going to start in the heart of Kentucky. As a matter of fact, I think it was three times. One for the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. I think that's right. Well, anyways, that sounds cool. But God says, I'm going to pour myself out into Campbellsville, Kentucky. You know, this prophesied in California a couple years ago that God was going to pour himself out into Campbellsville, Kentucky. You know, you can't tell me God ain't doing nothing. People in California know of Campbellsville. Come on. You're doing something if you think of Campbellsville, because Campbellsville is hard to get to. But anyways, going on. All right, going on. God is going to take you somewhere. If you're following the cloud, okay, everybody look up. Say, I'm following the cloud. I'm following the cloud. Everybody look to your neighbor and say, there's a cloud coming. You know, some of you, you haven't seen God before. Oh, God, come on. There's a cloud coming onto your life that you've never seen before. You've never experienced God before. Somebody in here is not saved tonight, but they're about to see the God cloud. Somebody in here is about to receive God into their life tonight for the very first time. Yeah, we was back there praying a while ago, and God said, Jared, I'm about to pour myself into somebody tonight. He said, you better get ready, boy, because I'm about to make you run. You know, somebody in here tonight is about to receive the God cloud for the very first time. Then it's your choice after you receive that, whether to follow the God cloud or to give up. You know, where's that married couple at? They're right back here. I see them. Yeah. It's your choice now whether you follow God, follow the God cloud, or you turn around and go somewhere else. Ball's in your court. You know, we've done our job, but it's also our job to invest in you. So we're not done with you. You know, we'll never be done with you. This church family loves you. And we're so glad that you're a part of this church. So glad. And we're so glad to know that we're going to see you in heaven with us. We're so glad of that. But going on, God says, trust in me and have faith. I can't help but think about Brian's sermon he preached a couple months ago. It's a final answer. I trust him. You know, when you're looking up, you can't see nothing else. You know, I got here earlier today, and I thought it was really cool. I looked over top of the sanctuary, right over top of the sanctuary. There's a huge white cloud sitting there. I said, come on, Jesus. You know, I said, come on, Jesus. Because God says, I'm resting myself over top of Elkhorn Baptist Church like never before. I'm about to do something over top of Elkhorn Baptist Church like you've never seen before. But when you're looking up, you can't see anything else. I can't see you. I can't see to my side. I can see the lights. But when you're looking up, you can't see anything else. And so when you're walking and you trust God, say, God, I trust you. Final answer, Lord, I trust you. You're walking and you'll never see where you're going. But you know God's taking you somewhere. You know you're going somewhere. You need to trust in the Lord. You need to trust in the Lord, young lady. You need to quit trying to handle things on yourself. You need to quit trying to handle things on your own. Because God's going to do something inside of you tonight like you've never seen before. And God's going to change your life like never before. Because you're going to turn your focus onto God. Praise the name you guys come. Someone in here tonight. Well, hold on, I want to tell you something cool. I got into a really deep research on these clouds. I guess I kind of got addicted to it. But every time I get off work, or every time I'd be off, like Friday, I was on my computer all day researching clouds. And like, what does this cloud mean? What does this cloud mean? What does this cloud mean? What does it mean when the cloud's wavy? You know, I thought it was so cool. I've never liked studying, but I told Madison, I haven't studied this much since my junior year of high school. But you're going to love this. I want you to write this one down. The white puffy cloud. Come on, Jesus. Contains rain. Y'all get me this morning? That cloud over top of your, that cloud you're following contains rain. The cloud you're chasing after contains rain. That rain is the same rain we sang about 5, 10, 30 minutes ago. He says, I'm about to pour myself out onto your life. You know, that cloud you're chasing after, you need to keep chasing after that cloud. Because no, you may not see where you're going, but it's that trust factor, it's that faith factor. Say, God, I trust you. I trust you. I want your rain. I want to feel you, God. I see you. I want to feel you, God. God, pour out your rain. God, I want to feel your rain. The white cloud you're chasing contains rain. It's so good. That cloud, Beth, that cloud you're chasing contains rain. It's about to rain on your life. Spencer, it's about to rain on your life like never before. I've seen God do something so much in you the past 3 months. Whew. You're not the same Spencer I knew 3 years ago, because you've been chasing the rain cloud. You've been chasing the rain cloud. You've been chasing a cloud called glory. You've been chasing a cloud called glory. So church, tonight, I want to put the ball in your court. I've done my job. The Holy Ghost told me, shut up. What cloud are you chasing? What path are you on? What do you want with your life? Do you want depression for the rest of your life? You want to be tempted by alcohol for the rest of your life? You want to be tempted with pornography the rest of your life? You want to be tempted with lust or adultery the rest of your life? Or do you want rain? Do you want the Holy Ghost rain from the cloud called glory? The ball's in your court. What are you going to do with it? Tonight, this altar's open. Maybe you've never seen the God cloud before. Maybe you've never seen God before. Tonight's your night. If God is ever in this house, he is tonight just as much as he was this morning. Would you guys come? Stand and worship tonight. The God cloud. There's a cloud coming. There's someone here tonight. Who's it going to be? Maybe you've taken the wrong turn. Maybe you've tried to get ahead of God a little bit. Now's your chance to turn back around. I'll go back to the little minnows. You're going to be the one following the crowd. Swimming with the rest of them and say, well, they're doing fine. You know, we're going downstream. Did you know there's a waterfall ahead? Or are you going to turn around and go up back upstream to where God wants you to be? What are you going to do with yourself? Get one more toe. It's your fault you're hindering yourself. It's your fault. It's your fault you're depressed. It's your fault you have anxiety. It's your fault you're angry all the time. It's your fault. Stop blaming God for it. Please. Because God's never going to let you down. You know, I blame God for taking my daddy home for 10 years. Blamed him for it, man. I'd scream at him every night. Caused my mom to live in hell. Then I look back on it now. I said, God, I wouldn't be the man I am today if it wasn't for you. Because I'd still be sucking on my Similac for my daddy. And I wouldn't be sitting here today. God never let me down. God's never going to let you down. Because my daddy ain't sick no more. Daddy don't hurt no more. That thing God took from you, he didn't take it from you. He did it to better yourself. He did it to give you something you'd never have if it was still part of your life. I wouldn't have this today if he was still here. It was because of that step that I'm standing here today. Don't you dare blame God for something that he didn't do to you. Church, you guys come. I want them to sing this song. Hold on, I want to read you one more verse. Going back to the cloud thing. I'm sorry, I'm way off subject today. It says, so, there it is. Seeking after God, you're looking up to God, you're following him. Say, God, I want nothing more than to be in your presence. Here's what he says. He says, when you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you pass through the rivers, sweep over you. You might be up to your neck. You might not know where your next meal is going to come from, but you're going to get a meal. You're going to get that gas money. You're going to get that house you need. Maybe not the big one you want, but you're going to get that house you need. When you walk through the fire, will not be burnt. You may feel like you're going through hell right now. You may feel like, well, God, I'm going to go home and kill myself tonight. You're walking through the fire, but you're not being burned. You're still breathing. You're still walking. You still have purpose for life. You have a reason you're standing here today. That's my favorite part. It says the flames will not set you ablaze, because those flames are not God's flames. God's flames will set you on fire. So church, you guys come tonight. Seek after God. Seek after His Holy Ghost reign. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. Never. You're not going to be burned. Trust God. Trust Him. Give it to Him. Let Him have it. He wants it. Let Him have it. Give it up. I held on to that depression for 10 years. When I gave it up, my joy came back. I got my life back. I got everything I needed. I was happy. I got a family that loves me. When you give it up, there's blessings waiting on you. Maybe it's something different tonight. Maybe it's an addiction to cigarettes or alcohol or sex. Premarital sex. If you're married, go for it. Premarital sex. Maybe you need to give that up today. Maybe you need to give up your life today. Don't kill yourself physically. Kill yourself spiritually. And let God revive you. Tonight's a night of transformation. We're about to go from depression to joy tonight. You're going from anxiety to happiness tonight. You're going from hatred to love tonight. We're going from wondering to knowing tonight. We're going from distracted to focused tonight. Tonight is a night of transformation. So guys, you guys come. I want to step aside. I've done all I need to do. God, you pour yourself out. Show your people just how much you love them.